pleasure to welcome you all this morning. This is the final in our series for this fall in the Business Breakfast. We'll be back in the late winter, early spring with another series, so keep your eyes peeled for all that. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker this morning. Amy Raskin is from AllianceBernstein. I also do want to begin by thanking Jane Staunton for her help in arranging for today's presentation, also to AllianceBernstein for sponsoring today's event. So we appreciate that very much. As you probably a lot of you already know, AllianceBernstein provides diversified investment management services worldwide to institutional clients, high net worth individuals, and retail investors, and provides independent investment research, trading, and brokerage-related services through the revered Sanford Bernstein operation. The firm employs more than 500 investment professionals with expertise in a variety of investment vehicles, and through its subsidiaries and joint ventures operates in more than 20 countries. Amy Raskin, our speaker today, is Senior Vice President and Director of Research on Strategic Change for AllianceBernstein. She's a member of the U.S. Mid-Cap Growth Team and the U.S. Strategic Research Investment Strategy Committee. She joined the firm in 2000 as a U.S. growth equity analyst covering networking and telecom equipment, a position she held until the fall of 2006. Prior to joining the firm, Ms. Raskin worked as a telecom analyst for DLJ and as an investment banking analyst for Lehman Brothers. You remember that firm, I think. She also worked at JP Morgan as a telecom products manager. She graduated from the University of Pennsylvania with a BSc in engineering. To frame today's presentation, I do want to introduce Jane Staunton, and then she will introduce Amy Raskin.
Thank you, Paul, and good morning, everyone. I would like to thank Concordia College for having us speak this morning on what I think is a very interesting and far-reaching topic. Also with me this morning, Amy obviously is going to be talking on the investment implications of climate change, but also with me is Doris Meister, who is the managing director of our private client group in New York. And we'll all be available after the presentation for any questions that you may have. What I would like to do is actually just take a couple of minutes to put some perspective around Bernstein's research, and in particular, the research that Amy's going to share with you this morning. At Bernstein, our sole focus is investment research and investment management. So no matter where we invest or what we invest in, our approach is always the same, and that's intensive research. Our chairman, Lou Sanders, likes to say that the company's DNA is research, from which everything else flows. Now, with over 300 analysts around the world covering 30 countries, our definition of research is very expansive. So it includes fundamental research, quantitative, economic, credit research, and then also research on strategic change. So I guess the question you're probably thinking is, so what exactly is research on strategic change? Well, what Amy and her group do is they approach research very differently than fundamental research analysts. Fundamental research analysts normally cover a specific industry and companies within that industry on a very bottom-up approach. What the strategic change team does is they look to find investable ideas that stem from economic and technological changes that are powerful enough to profoundly influence corporate performance and earnings across multiple industries. So it's really about understanding issues early on that have the potential to revolutionize various industries around the world. And climate change is just one of those issues. And this is actually the fifth in a series of reports that we've published. Now, Amy's team has spent over 2 years researching climate change and have interviewed over 500 people to really investigate how is the world likely to respond to the threat of climate change over the next 20 years. And which companies and which industries are likely to be the winners and which are likely to be the losers. So unlike many other voices in the climate change debate, our conclusions, some of which you may find controversial, are not based on any political beliefs Our sole focus is to develop research insights that will help us give clients better investment outcomes. So with that background, I would now like to turn it over to Amy.
Thank you. Thanks, Jane. I'm glad to be here. And can everyone see me through this? Okay, sorry. Okay. I guess you don't really need to see me. I'm going to go through, as Jane said, the investment implications of climate change. And this is work that we primarily did in 2006 and 2007. As you can see, the report was published in January of this year. I can bring you up to date maybe in Q&A, but most of this work is based on work we've done a few years ago. As Jane said, my group does thematic research, basically. So some of the projects we're working on now involve stem cells and the potential to revolutionize the healthcare industry. We've done a lot of work on broadband, on geographic locations like China and India. So we look at big secular changes that have the potential to impact investments across multiple sectors, which is different than traditional analysts that are typically focused on one sector. So our previous report was on hybrid vehicles, which actually stemmed from the thesis of that report started out as what happens when are oil prices sustainably high? And so then, just to give you an example of how we conduct our research, we went out to prove that oil prices would be sustainably high. And to believe that, you have to believe that transportation's going to always depend on oil. So then we went to go prove that the internal combustion engine would forever be the only engine driving, driving, no pun intended, the transportation fleet. And we felt that that wasn't true. The internal combustion engine's been around for 100 years, but there's, you know, better technology now. And I'll touch on some of that in this report. But that's really what my group does. So today I'm going to talk about climate change. And I'm really not going to discuss the science behind climate change, although I will touch on it briefly at times. But as you can see from this display, the scientific underpinnings of this topic are indeed quite complex. And as you heard, I have an engineering degree and I'm pretty technical. I will say this is the most technical and most difficult topic I've ever studied. And I'm doing a report now on stem cells. But the study of climate science is really, really difficult. And it's something that nobody really knows. Nobody has ever lived in a world with atmospheric concentration where it is today. So we don't have models that can go back and look at it and say, okay, you know, last time this happened, this is what the world looked like. And I'll show you that as well. The last time we were at atmospheric concentration of where we were today, there was no ice on the world, in the world. There was palm trees in the Arctic, and it was about 36 million to 55 million years ago. So our models, anybody who tells you they know exactly what we're doing to the planet is not telling you the truth. But regardless of whether you or I believe the scientific arguments that man-made greenhouse gases are resulting in climate change, and regardless of where we may stand in the political debate, one thing is clear. Regulations aimed at reducing greenhouse gas emissions associated with climate change are being adopted in much of the world, and they will become more pervasive and stricter in the future. And these regulations will impact trillions of dollars of investment. We estimate that efforts to reduce greenhouse gas emissions will cause at least a doubling in annual capital spending in the power generation sector alone versus our already aggressive business as usual estimates. And annual service-related spending will increase proportionately as well. This increase in spending will create many investment opportunities. Some of the companies that will benefit most are makers of power generation equipment and certain utilities. However, there will also be significant investment opportunities in a wide variety of other industries, ranging from makers of transmission equipment, power semiconductors, hybrid vehicle manufacturers and their battery suppliers, to pipeline operators, oil field service firms, and engineering and construction companies. But on the downside, consumers will pay more for electricity, and large consumers of electricity may feel a margin squeeze due to higher prices. So just to briefly discuss some of the science related to climate change. And again, I recognize that this is a dramatic oversimplification of a very complicated topic. But nonetheless, as you can see from this chart, temperature has fluctuated in a fairly steady range for the past 400,000 years. And the fluctuations have correlated very tightly with atmospheric concentration of carbon dioxide. Recently, we have witnessed a significant increase in carbon dioxide emissions, which has led to a corresponding increase in atmospheric concentration in terms of parts per million. There's no doubt we've broken out of a range that has persisted for a very long time. And when I say parts per million, I literally mean parts per million. Out of every 1 million particles in the atmosphere, right now 380 of them are carbon dioxide. Further, given our current infrastructure and way of life, almost regardless of the actions we take in the very short term, atmospheric concentration of CO2 will continue to increase. Only the level of the increase and the time frame in which we get to potentially critical threshold levels is within our control. Today, I will outline a set of very feasible actions that we could take over the next few decades to significantly reduce the pace at which we build up atmospheric concentration of carbon dioxide. And I'll discuss the potential investment-related consequences of taking these actions. Now, before I continue, let me sidetrack for a second and make a few points. First, I do recognize that carbon dioxide is not the only man-made greenhouse gas, but it is the most pervasive, so I'm going to focus much of my discussion around carbon dioxide today. Second, I'm going to focus much of my discussion on the power generation or electricity segment. This sector represents over 35% of global man-made CO2 emissions, and its share of the problem is projected to increase over time. Further, many of the solutions applicable for this sector are also relevant in manufacturing and industrial processes that together represent another 25% plus of emissions. The good news is that power generation sources are relatively few and easily concentrated, and this makes tackling the problem much easier. This chart depicts each stationary source of CO2 emissions as a vertical line along the x-axis. In 2005, the largest 150 emitters spewed out as much carbon dioxide as the entire global car fleet. Let me say that again. 150 sites around the world, we know exactly where they are, put as much carbon dioxide into the atmosphere as every passenger car on the road. The top 1,000 stationary sources accounted for 30% of CO2 emissions. Half of these sources are in either the U.S. or China, and most of them are power plants or cement factories. If we reduced emissions from just 8,000 locations and didn't grow or build new facilities, we could eliminate 45% of global CO2 emissions. And here are the actual sites. We know exactly where they are. The red dots represent power plants. The green dots are other sources. The concentrations are where you would expect: the U.S., China, Western Europe, Japan, South Africa. So when we were looking at this, the first thing we did was examine all the possible ways that we can reduce emissions. One way is just to use less energy. So when you burn coal or oil, you take the carbon dioxide in that physical entity and release it into the atmosphere. So if we just use less energy and we drive our cars less, air condition and light, fewer and smaller buildings, and pull the plug on many consumer devices, such as flat screen TVs, laptops, iPods, etc., we could reduce emissions. And this would be a fairly cheap solution, but no one's going to agree to do it, so we crossed it off our list. And I'll come back to this chart a few times during the presentation. The green filled in circle means low, so low cost in this scenario. An empty circle means high, so in this instance, high impact on people's lives, nobody would be happy, and high obstacles to implementation, nobody would actually do it. A half circle, which you'll see in later slides, indicates moderate impact, obstacles, or cost. So our second option is to somehow increase the Earth's natural absorption of CO2. Now this route's more palatable because we would not have to change our way of life, but it would be very difficult, if not impossible technologically, and the cost would be exorbitant. So we cross this option off too. This would be, you know, let's just plant rainforests everywhere that, you know, plants will naturally absorb the CO2. Unfortunately, the amount of land that we have is just not enough to combat this problem. Even if we moved everybody into apartment buildings and planted every possible tree we could, it really wouldn't make a big difference. So that brings us to our third option and our first feasible choice. Let's get energy from sources that don't create carbon dioxide as a byproduct. So the two main categories that we know about and use today that fit this description are nuclear power generators and renewables such as wind, solar, and hydropower. These options are costly, but they're not prohibitively expensive, and the technologies are proven. And while there are some political obstacles to nuclear, which we can discuss if you'd like, in many regions, opposition to this energy source is waning. So today, there are over 400 nuclear reactors in operation around the world. Together, they generate 367 gigawatts of electric capacity. The IEA, or Energy Information Agency, estimates that this figure will increase moderately to about 481 gigawatts of capacity in 2030. And we chose the 2030 timeframe for our analysis because it's not so far into the future to be irrelevant to current stock prices, yet it provides a long enough period of time to achieve a reasonable level of infrastructure transformation. An MIT study on nuclear power recently argued that nuclear generating capacity could more than double over the next 25 years, mainly due to a concerted effort to reduce emissions. The MIT study did not provide a specific number for 2030, but given their longer-term estimates, we approximated that under their scenario, there would be about 770 gigawatts of nuclear capacity in that year. We are even more aggressive than MIT. We estimate that by 2030, there will be over 900 gigawatts of nuclear capacity, almost double the EIA's estimates, and more than 2.5 times current capacity. We base this forecast purely on our estimates of the economics of nuclear power. Simply put, nuclear power is the cheapest way to generate electricity when the cost of curbing carbon emissions is taken into account. As you can see, if we are right, the incremental annual nuclear expenditures would be enormous. By 2020, the world will be spending close to $100 billion per year on nuclear equipment versus less than $10 billion today. Again, this figure does not include service-related revenue. The tenfold increase in spending would be on equipment alone. And this would obviously create a much bigger opportunity for companies such as Areva, Toshiba Westinghouse, GE, Alstom, Cameco, URS, and others. As a result of this spending, nuclear power would represent a larger share of global power generation. Today, the world consumes about 18 trillion kilowatt hours of electricity per year. And again, this figure is a little bit old, but it's roughly probably 2% higher than that. We estimate that as a result of global economic growth, the figure will almost double to about 30 trillion kilowatt hours in 2030, or a compounded annual growth rate, as I said, of about 2.2%. It's probably higher in 2007, lower in 2008, and still lower in 2009, unfortunately. So if our nuclear forecast is accurate, It implies that 25% of electricity demand needs will be satisfied via nuclear power in 2030 versus only 15% today. Now let's turn to renewable energy sources. Except for hydropower, renewable sources generate an extremely small portion of our global supply of electricity. Our model incorporates a huge increase in renewable energy. But unlike our estimates for nuclear energy, our estimates for renewables are not driven by economics, but rather by the strong political support for them in many parts of the world. Again, we are more aggressive than the EIA in estimating that over 2,300 gigawatts of generating capacity based on renewable sources will be in place by 2030. Most of the increase will be in wind and solar power, but we do also see some gains in hydro. Now, this chart highlights some of the shortcomings related to renewable energy. One of the largest issues is connecting renewables to the remainder of the electric grid, since they are often located in fairly remote areas. Tackling this challenge will create a significant opportunity for the makers of transmission and distribution equipment, such as ABB. Another challenge is to vary other power sources up and down, depending on the productivity of a renewable at a specific point in time. In other words, if you typically get 10% of your electricity from wind turbines, and the wind is not blowing on a particular day, you need a backup resource to account for the shortfall. Nonetheless, as I said earlier, there is strong political support for renewables in many parts of the world, and spending on renewable resources will increase. As you can see from this chart, in our scenario analysis, spending doubles from about $70 billion per year today to close to $150 billion per year at the end of our forecast period. But interestingly, we don't expect the share of electricity generated from renewable sources to meaningfully increase because of the much lower utilization rates of renewable capacity. A nuclear reactor can operate 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, but a wind turbine only generates electricity when the wind is blowing, and solar is obviously only useful when the sun is shining. Thus, it will be hard to make a big difference in the composition of power generation using renewable energy unless there is a technological breakthrough that we don't foresee right now. So, increasing the use of non-fossil fuel energy sources can indeed reduce emissions. But as you can see from this chart, even with our massive growth rates, the electricity generated by renewables and nuclear won't be enough to satisfy global demand in 2030. Thus, to maintain global growth without curbing our lifestyles, the world will have to find a way to reduce emissions from fossil fuels. That is, we must start capturing the carbon dioxide emitted from burning fossil fuels and put it somewhere safe so it doesn't escape into the atmosphere. Now, this will be costly, but it is technologically feasible and will not lower our standard of living. And basically, we don't think we have a choice. So, but we do have a few choices of fossil fuels. There's coal, oil, and natural gas. As this slide shows, coal really stands out as the obvious choice. It has been significantly cheaper than oil or natural gas for the last 10 years, and it's also much more abundant than oil or natural gas. And happily, the coal reserves are located in key regions such as rapidly growing China and India, as well as in many European countries, Australia, and the US. But from a carbon dioxide perspective, coal is the least attractive option. Burning it emits almost twice as much CO2 per megawatt hour than burning natural gas. So the billion-dollar question, or the trillion-dollar question, depending on inflation, is how can we reduce coal plants' carbon emissions? And the question has a very simple answer. It'll just take money. It will take lots of money, actually, to clean up all those coal-burning plants that dominate the list of point sources generating most of the man-made CO2 that I showed you earlier. But again, the other options aren't sufficient, so we believe the money will be spent and mankind will indeed find a way to clean coal. So how will we do this? And this is going to get a little technical, but the first natural response is to try to retrofit our existing coal plants in order to salvage some of the trillions of dollars that we've already invested in our current infrastructure. And there are two ways utilities can try to retrofit these plants. First, they can try to add a chemical process or a membrane in the plant's chimney or flue that separates the carbon dioxide from the rest of the gas discharged. Now, this is difficult because the carbon dioxide represents less than 15% of the flue gas, and the technology has not yet been deployed on a large enough scale to prove that it works. So think about it this way. It's not quite the same, but think about if we just tried to take the carbon dioxide out of this room. So as I said earlier, 380 out of every million particles are carbon dioxide. So it's not quite the same because it's more concentrated in a flue gas, but it's not pressurized. It's a similar problem. And carbon dioxide is fairly inert, so it doesn't react well. So this is something that a lot of scientists are working on. We actually have an investment in one company that's trying to do this, but it hasn't been proven yet on a large scale that this works. And it's expensive. It will add, we estimate, about 4.5 cents to the cost of electricity per kilowatt hour. And again, these numbers are old. That 4.5 cent number is on a 7.2% base. And one's a cost and one's a price, so they're not exactly comparable. But that's the magnitude of the problem that we're trying to solve. The other answer in retrofitting is to burn the coal in pure oxygen rather than burning it in air. And that basically takes the nitrogen out of the equation and gives you a much more concentrated stream of carbon dioxide, which makes capture much easier. The problem is actually burning something in pure oxygen makes it even hotter than it would be. And so it's actually a materials problem. But this is a much more proven methodology, and actually the cost is, it adds to the cost, but not quite as much. And there are a lot of investments that we're making around burning coal and pure oxygen. But if a utility is building a new plant, rather than trying to retrofit an old plant, they would likely choose a different option altogether. IGCC, or Integrated Gasification Combined Cycle, is already deployed in industries such as chemical manufacturing, but it's new to the power generation market. IGCC produces electricity by turning coal first into a synthetic gas, which is a mixture of hydrogen and carbon monoxide. And this synthetic gas, or syngas, is cleaned prior to being burned in a generator at a high pressure, which makes capture much easier. An IGCC plant is significantly more expensive than a traditional coal plant, but it is much less expensive than building a coal plant and then trying to retrofit it to capture the CO2. GE, Siemens, and others are feverishly working on bringing IGCC technology to the power generation sector. And currently, there are more than 30 projects underway and many, many more on the drawing board. We think that companies will retrofit their largest, most efficient plants and likely replace smaller, inefficient facilities that do not justify the incremental expenditure. We also think that in time, IGCC power plants will be the norm for plants built to generate incremental power if the cost of other technologies doesn't come down meaningfully. As a result, we believe annual spending on coal power will increase significantly from about $90 billion per year to over $200 billion per year. And again, this is on the equipment alone. Although the companies that participate in this market tend to be large, diverse multinationals, the market growth is enough to increase the revenue and earnings growth significantly, even for these industrial giants. As a result of this incremental spending and cleaning, we project that coal will retain its position as the largest fuel for power generation. Yet the carbon emissions from coal-burning power plants will be much lower than they are today. In addition, we expect an entirely new market to emerge around transporting and sequestering the carbon dioxide that's captured. After all, the CO2 will have to be put somewhere. And most of the storage sites will be oil fields, saline aquifers, or other underground pores in the earth, such as mines. And this chart gives you an idea of how big this new market could be. By 2030, we may be transporting over 500 billion cubic feet of CO2 per day. That is almost double the current amount of natural gas we transport, which is about 285 billion cubic feet. Now, the CO2 will likely be transported over shorter distances than natural gas, but nonetheless, this massive new volume will likely require at least a doubling of the current global pipeline infrastructure. Also, once the CO2 is at the appropriate sites, it will have to be injected safely into the storage facilities, thereby creating a great new business for oil field service companies. And the oil field service companies already know how to inject carbon dioxide into the ground because they do it today to raise the pressure in oil wells and make it easier to pump out oil. But there's not yet been a large-scale deployment of the process solely for the purpose of CO2 sequestration, although scientists do not see any technical obstacles to underground or even deep-sea storage of CO2. A lot of money will be spent to make the transition to an electricity infrastructure that emits far less carbon dioxide than the one we have today. It will literally cost trillions of dollars in aggregate. But compared to global capital spending, this task is entirely feasible. Here's an annual breakdown of incremental spending by type of power plant. According to our analysis, coal and nuclear will be the biggest winners, but renewables will also experience much stronger growth. But where will these dollars come from? Most likely they will come from you and me through higher electricity prices. And this won't be popular, but higher prices will inspire more efficient use of electricity. Thus, efficiency improvements will be both an indirect result of efforts to reduce carbon dioxide emissions, as well as a strategy onto itself. It is a result because reducing emissions will likely cause high prices to go up, and higher prices inspire both individuals and businesses to improve efficiency. And it's a strategy because some governments will set efficiency standards in order to reduce demand for energy and thus reduce emissions. So here's the proof that prices drive efficiency. In countries where electricity is relatively cheap due to the availability of cheap hydropower, such as Norway, or due to subsidies like in China or India, economic output per unit of electricity used is low. In countries where it is expensive, usually due to high taxation, like in Denmark, economic output per unit of electricity used is high. And here is the proof that regulation can spur increased energy efficiency. As this chart shows, California's strict standards have dramatically increased energy efficiency there over the past two decades, even as electricity consumption per capita increased in the rest of the United States. Currently, many regions around the world are considering implementation of even stricter energy standards. One way to improve energy efficiency has been to switch from mechanical systems, which are often wasteful, to electric systems that are far more precise and efficient. As I mentioned earlier, our previous report on hybrid vehicles demonstrated our belief that the days of the traditional internal combustion engine solely powering automobiles are numbered because the electric motor in a hybrid vehicle is far more efficient than the internal combustion engine and therefore decreases total energy consumption. Internal combustion engines are inefficient primarily, do I have the chart here? Yeah, primarily because so much of the energy is lost as heat. You can see from this display an electric motor is 5 to 6 times more efficient than an engine. And another way that I sometimes use to describe this is think about your microwave oven versus your gas stove and just how much more precise you can be in with one versus the other. And that's basically the transition that every sector has actually made with the exception of transportation. And we can go into details if you want. But Let me just assert that we expect the conversion of the global car fleet to hybrid vehicles to reduce total energy consumption and carbon emissions, especially once plug-in hybrids are introduced and the electricity used to charge these batteries come from a clean source, be it nuclear, clean coal, or renewables. Now, you may be wondering how much of a difference global carbon emissions all of the actions I outlined will make. Well, the answer is they will make a big difference. Our research shows that these manageable actions will reduce CO2 emissions enough so that by 2030, only 26 gigatons will be emitted, compared to the EIA's estimate of 43 gigatons if nothing's done. The largest reductions in CO2 emissions come from the steps we discussed, namely shifting to nuclear and renewables, and most notably, capturing the carbon dioxide from coal emissions. However, even 26 gigatons per year will be too much to reverse the warming trend. But it will probably be enough to delay the world reaching the critical 450 to 550 parts per million level of atmospheric concentration that scientists say could be catastrophic. Further, we think that as these strategies achieve mass scale and success, improvements and new technologies will emerge that will make it feasible for governments to tighten regulations even further over time. So there is hope. We can conquer this issue. Now, before I end, let me quickly address some of the macroeconomic implications of combating climate change or reducing greenhouse gas emissions. One, new nuclear plants will be built. High voltage transmission lines will be laid across the globe to connect remote wind farms and other renewables to the power grid. Pipelines will be built to transmit CO2 from coal and natural gas plants. All of these factors will create relatively high-paying jobs in many countries. The companies that take the lead in developing advanced technologies addressing this market will have an opportunity to gain significant market share. The countries where they are located will benefit from exporting these technologies. Electricity prices will go up almost everywhere, and this will encourage adoption of more efficient systems and raise energy productivity. And the stranglehold that oil currently has on transportation will come to an end faster than it would otherwise. So as we began by saying, our study was focused on investment implications. I alluded to many as I went through the presentation, but to wrap up, many, many industries will be affected. I've listed a few of them here. The pluses indicate that companies that participate in this sector will benefit from combating climate change. The more pluses, the larger the benefit. A minus indicates that the impact will be negative. And where there are pluses and minuses, it means that some will benefit while others may be hurt. In aggregate, trillions of dollars will be spent, and many markets will double, triple, and even quadruple from current levels. Now, this won't occur overnight. There's lots of work to do, and several countries, such as you know as the U.S., is the leading candidate, do not have coordinated policies in place to encourage such spending to begin. But companies know that the regulations are coming, and the smart ones are spending the research and development dollars now to be ready for when the regulations are in place and demand rises for technologies that provide a solution. So thank you very much for your time and attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Amy. Just so we don't interrupt the Q&A session, I do want to remind folks that 8:40, those who want to get the shuttle to the train station, it'll be waiting out in the front oval, so if you need to leave, please leave quietly, but please stick around for Q&A.
Questions? What's the comparative cost of transporting energy on the electric grid compared to pipeline and rail transportation?
The electric grid is actually amazingly efficient. So, but I will say, even rail and oil transportation is pretty efficient too. That's not a big problem. Most high voltage transmission lines lose about 3% of the energy in Across the wire?
Building
depends a lot on the cost of the commodities at the time. So it's really much more dependent on, for pipelines, the cost of steel and labor and things like that. But the upfront cost, once you amortize it over the life, is not usually typically not that great. Right now, with the recent commodity spike, it went up. But what you actually just need, it's a lot of upfront costs. So you need the capital markets to sort of be cooperative to give the loans, because the upfront capital cost is so high. So that's really more of the issue rather than the actual cost. It's just that so much is upfront, and then you amortize it over 50, 100 years.
Could you explain power electronics?
Power electronics. Sure. I can go into a lot of detail about this, but basically what there's new semiconductor technology that lets semiconductors transmit very high voltages. And that's really the technological breakthrough that actually allows hybrids to proliferate and be on the road today. There's been advances in battery technologies, which are very important, but there's a technology called IGBTs, insulated gate bipolar transistors, which basically allows what your typical semiconductors do in your computer, which is just move around very small bits of power very precisely, to move around to do a lot of work and control high voltages very precisely. And that's a growing field, and actually a field that hasn't gotten a lot of attention for a long time. But they're actually very expensive components, and they're just basically advanced semiconductors.
Yes, what were some of the factors that make countries want to do this? I mean, is it there warm or cold countries, or they're industrial, or they're third world, or they're democracies? I mean, what are some of the
Honestly, to date, it's been more social conscious than anything else, than a true economic reason. But I actually think going forward, it really will be economically driven, which is why I do think we're going to get to the nuclear answer. And that's because companies won't want to locate in areas where energy is a very high cost for them. So you're already seeing Iceland trying to woo aluminum companies. Alcoa is just building a plant there to take advantage of their geothermal resources, saying to energy intense industries, look, this is going up as a percentage of your cost. You know, even add transportation in, that cost is going to be so high for you. We have natural resources. We can give you the advantage of cheap power. Over time, I have no doubt that there will be tariffs if countries don't reduce their carbon emissions. There'll be tariffs added to their exports by countries that import them to pay that penalty. So this will become a big economic issue. You're already seeing Google try to locate their data centers by the Tennessee Valley to try to take advantage of hydro. Cooling costs or electricity costs for data centers are now probably the highest cost, more so than the equipment. So increasingly, you're going to see this really being driven by economics. Yes?
One of the concerns with nuclear is what to do with the waste.
Mm-hmm.
What happens to all this carbon dioxide that we're pumping into the earth?
Actually, we're very, very fortunate that most of the carbon dioxide in this planet is located in the earth. And the biggest difference between us and Venus is the carbon dioxide is in Venus's atmosphere rather than the Earth. Actually, Venus should be colder than the Earth because it's a much more reflective planet, even though it's closer to the sun. But it's not, because 90% of their 90% of their carbon dioxide's actually in the atmosphere. This is carbon, not carbon dioxide. And it's also old, so the numbers are going to be a little bit different. But this is the basis of the scientific argument. They're saying there's a natural, very natural carbon cycle. So volcanoes and other things put carbon into the atmosphere. Trees and humans take it out. So it, there's a very natural carbon cycle. But as you can see, most of the carbon is actually under the ocean in our atmosphere today. So putting it back in the ground, I have not seen any reputable scientist say that that could actually be a problem. It's actually, we're basically taking it out of the ground in the form of coal or oil. And so we're going to actually put it over the ground, and in years, it will form other materials. And it's, the argument around the scientific cause is that if you look at even this, and again, this is an old chart, but if you just look at the man-made part of the carbon cycle is actually pretty small. It shouldn't be a problem. And actually, there are natural reserves of carbon dioxide in the Earth today that companies are tapping into and then using for enhanced oil recovery.
In your analysis of the nuclear reactors, how do you factor in the disposal problems, security problems, and the removal of the protective government regs?
I don't think we're going to remove in Europe, you're saying, and in California, there are regulations that ban the building of new nuclear.
I'm talking about the federal government had protective regs.
Right.
Anderson Insurance.
Right.
How do you factor in the disposal problems, long-term disposal security problems?
Security,
analysis of
right. Security. So security is. I get this question a lot. Security. There's a difference between enriched uranium and weapons grade plutonium. That's very different. So, enriched uranium, from a terrorist point of view, is not a particular threat. If you could make that into weapons-grade plutonium, that's a real threat. But people ask me all the time, what happens if a nuclear reactor gets bombed? Chances are, if you have a bomb, you're going to put it in a city, not a nuclear reactor. So you're going to do much more damage in a city, in a high-dense population, rather than actually at a nuclear facility, because a nuclear facility will most likely shut down. Japan is on an earthquake fault and has more earthquakes than any other country, and has a lot of nuclear reactors, so a lot of their energy, and has never had a problem. Three Mile Island was actually, there was no radiation from Three Mile Island that was ever detected. Chernobyl was a big issue, and was a travesty, but it was very bad technology and nothing that actually the Western world would have ever used. So from a security standpoint, it is an issue. But making weapons-grade plutonium requires so much energy it's very hard to do in secret, because you would actually see it coming from the grid, that you have to pull that much energy to do it, because it's a complicated process. But it's very different than your enriched uranium, and it requires a lot more energy. There's a lot of noise around it. Regarding the waste is an issue, and it does have to be buried someplace for thousands and thousands of years. But we do it today. It's not an insurmountable issue. France is 80% nuclear energy, and that again was an economic decision that they were highly dependent on oil in the 70s. They had no coal, so. They wanted energy independence, and they built, a nuclear fleet. And from an economic perspective, there are issues. There's nothing in part of this. There's all of this has issues. But from and what I'm looking at is purely from an economic perspective.
It seems that they're really being ignored. They're not really being factored into the analysis, honestly. That's the impression you get.
What? Well, we haven't built a nuclear plant here in a long time, so I think it's really been factored in. And I think it's actually been probably over-factored in than it probably should be. And we have actually a big problem, because nuclear reactor typically has 40-year life. And so most of our nuclear reactors are not only they're actually have to either be renewed for 20 years or be shut down. So we're actually, of our 104 nuclear reactors in this country, we're potentially going to shut down 20 to 40. And so not only, so we have to get that energy from someplace. So you can either build new nuclear reactors, you can try to do it with renewables, but it's going to cost people a lot more money. It's going to be far less productive. And then you have coal or natural gas, and then you're going to increase your CO2. So you have a lot of issues. And there's not, unfortunately, there's not a great, easy answer that's just, oh, we could do that without any issue. So it's just a matter of weighing all the issues. I think it's very important that nuclear be part of the solution.
The thing is to get the truth out. That's the important.
Couldn't agree with you more. There's a lot of misinformation about climate change out there.
Amy, when you spoke about renewables and requiring some major technological breakthrough, from an investment perspective, would that include storing that energy that's captured when the sun's out and when the wind is blowing? And where does that stand in terms of development?
Battery technology, we actually have... I run our venture capital effort as well, so we actually have a great company that's going to come public soon that makes advanced batteries. Battery technology is one of the most important technologies. It's very hard. The difference between electricity and every other commodity is that you can't store it. Our best way of storing of energy right now is pumping water up and then letting it fall down when we want it. That's absolutely true. We don't have good energy storage options. And we're still a long way from solving that problem. I mean, there are 1 megawatt, and I was talking a lot about, we use 16 trillion kilowatt, 18 trillion kilowatts, but 1 megawatt of storage is about 53 tractor trailers of batteries. So it's we're not going to solve that. I mean, there's concentrated solar power that heats rice or something in a tube that tries to store the energy later. There's lots of different ways to try to combat that problem, but we haven't found a good answer yet. And I'm not sure that one actually exists. We collaborated a lot with some professors at Harvard for this, and what they'll tell you is if anyone tells you that they're going to have something better than what already exists in nature, they're lying. So you see some of these solar companies that say we can convert sunlight at rates 2 to 3x of photosynthesis that's evolved over millions and millions of years. It's probably not true. So there are physical limitations, but yes, if we could store electricity, none of this would be an issue. But that's the problem, that we can't do that well. Right.
Is there any prospect that superconducting cables will be used to transmit electricity over long distances in this country?
Yeah, in certain areas, absolutely. AMCC or ASMC, American Superconductor, is a company that's trying to do that. In particularly dense areas where you don't want to lay multiple fibers or multiple cables, that's being looked at, like in Manhattan and things like that. I think it's, if you're asking...
Long term, we have this wind corridor in the middle of the country, and that's not where people live.
Right.
Is superconducting cable the way to get that?
It is. You can time shift it a little bit by transmitting it cross country. The problem also with wind is that it's most powerful typically at night when electricity use is not peak. I don't think it's actually going to be used for the wind corridor but I do think what you're going to see is a lot of these small coal plants eventually be shut down, and you're going to have larger generating facilities that are further apart, so you will need new transmission lines. I'm not sure if they're going to be superconductor cables or the regular cables that we have right now, but I do think you'll need an investment in transmission.
As part of this, could you turn it upside down and take a look at what business sectors would benefit from global warming?
You know, it's bad for polar bears, but... we didn't do that. There are a lot of reports out there that have tried to look at if...
Frederick Lomberg, I guess.
Yeah, if you know, it gets 1 degree warmer, can you grow more in Chicago area than you grow? I think what we did is much easier because it's much more concrete, and I feel like it's very hard to actually predict what happens with the atmosphere. There's a lot, it's very complicated. What role do clouds play? What, you know, the ocean has actually been increasing its absorption of carbon dioxide to try to compensate for what we're, you know, what we're doing. So there's, it's very complicated. So we didn't try to do that.
Mm-hmm. Is any work being done on splitting CO2 to carbon and oxygen? So you concentrate the carbon and just reuse it directly rather than trying to store it?
I have not seen anything on that, to be honest with you. So I wouldn't want to say I don't know. I know we talked a lot about separating oxygen in an air separation unit, but that's mainly from nitrogen rather than carbon. So
that's an old technology.
Right.
The name is very good.
No. Separating carbon from oxygen?
Oxygen from nitrogen.
Yeah, right. So I have not seen from carbon. No. Okay. Yeah.
There have been proposals to turn carbon dioxide into methanol.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Have you run any analysis of that?
I have not. I've seen them. And my guess is that from an energy perspective, it might be energy negative. It might take more to change the carbon, but I don't know.
There's a Nobel Prize winner at USC, so that's not true.
He's probably right. I have not. No, I haven't looked into it.
Well, there's a book called The Methanol Economy.
There's somebody else who actually... Zabrin, who's written something about that, again, I'm just not up to speed on that.
On the power electronics size question, is that, in terms of companies, position there to benefit, is that Intel or their companies?
No, it's not Intel. It's actually it's much more of older semiconductor companies
Texas Instruments?
No, Texas Instruments actually doesn't. It's like International Rectifier, Fairchild, ON Semiconductor, all have little bits of pieces of this in their business. Infineon, it's part of their business. So I think I don't want to give stock recommendations because all of these companies have a lot of hair on them too. But it's more of your analog semiconductor companies. It's more of your analog semiconductor companies that... Toyota is actually making their own for their hybrids.
Again, our sincerest thanks to Amy and to Alliance Bernstein for today, and Jane for all of her help in helping arrange this. Thanks so much, and we'll see you late winter.